because, you know, they keep hitting you with that time thing, is just start with Dennis. And I'm just going to pass the microphone down, and we are limited now to 4 minutes. So if I keep talking, it'll be 3.5, and, you know, just keep getting worse. Okay. So we're going to tell our little story. We're, whether it's, you know, just your story in your healthcare, in your story of taking control, being your own health advocate, or you want to talk about what you do as far as promoting health, holistic services. So we'll just start with Dennis and move on down.
Good afternoon, everybody. I enjoy being here today. I am especially overjoyed about being asked to serve on this panel. My name is Dr. Dennis Courtney. I am an alternative medical practitioner here in the South Wales area of Pittsburgh. My specialty, actually, is anesthesiology. Somehow, I got lost. I haven't seen an operating room in over 15 years, but what I have seen is a consultation practice involving some very exciting therapies over quite a long period of time. I have an opportunity to do a radio show. This has given me a whole bunch of extra added advantage to meet some brilliant clinicians, great authors, and over 20 years of doing that radio show has provided me a beacon by which I can communicate with you. This may be one of the few times I can do it face-to-face. I can tell you that I normally tend to irritate people. I really irritate my conventional medical colleagues who, for the longest time, look at me with much disdain. But even irritate the alternative medical community. I have been given the distinct privilege of being, I am the doctor who ruined vitamin C. I did so about 15 years ago. I'll let you in on a bit of a clue on how I ruined it, because when we found out that vitamin C was made from corn 99% of the time, that then led to the obvious conclusion that this is genetically modified stuff. And so the vitamin C issue really is quite clear now to be honored and observed by all. I am the doctor who absolutely ruined fish oil. And I've proudly said on my radio show many times, taking fish oil is hazardous to your health. And I have the information to back that up. And it will hold true over time, to be accurate. My most recent, and I can't claim that I've been the person to ruin it, but as of about a week ago, a loud shout came over the Pittsburgh area by a brilliant man we had in town. His name is Dr. Thomas Levy, wrote a book. His book is entitled Death by Calcium. So I open my radio shows now with a little mantra, which is, have you thrown away your calcium supplements today? And that's probably what you need to be dealing with them from this point forward. Calcium is extremely harmful. And I recommend that book. I'm excited because this month of April, we just passed, has been a great opportunity for me. I am involved with an interesting project involving ozone. And we in Pennsylvania have really missed this wonderful therapy because our state medical boards really never allow doctors to use it. We now operate under an FDA-approved IRB, and so this ozone message is going to be coming across louder and clearer. Follow me on the radio shows. You'll learn more about ozone. I would say to you, head to my website, head to the YouTube. There's quite a bit of information out there to acclimate you to something that seems very strange, maybe, but when you find out the power of it, you'll get quite comfortable with it. And after all, it's only oxygen. So I'm leaving today very much excited and in wonderment. I'm trying to find out the gentleman, I think it was a gentleman, who heard that tone for about a minute beyond when I did, because he's impersonating a beagle. Somebody can hear, has ears that can hear certain whistles that I can't. And my final closing excitable issue is that I can't wait. I want to get my picture taken with the Tibetan monk as he is texting on his iPhone. I thought that was pretty amazing.
Thank you, Dr. My name is Phyllis Morgan. I'm the program director of a nonprofit called Faith in Action. I have, I'm responsible for two offices, one in Murrysville and one in the Harrison City area. And what we do is we provide free non-medical assistance to senior citizens. And we consider a senior citizen to be someone 60 years of age and older. Whenever I came on as a program director, this was very idealistic because, as Dr. O'Neill was saying, we were taking a look at seniors and how seniors wanted to go down to the end of life, you know, drinking their pina coladas, sitting out there on a nice beach, making sure that everything was just fine, no financial responsibilities. They had all their work behind them, and now it was time to just sit back and relax. As the program director of this organization, I have found out that it's completely the opposite. I go in and I see senior citizens who are lonely, depressed, really have little communication with people on the outside. Sometimes there's not enough food in the house. And more importantly, whenever I took a look around at the seniors, whenever we do the intake, I'm seeing seniors with bottles and bottles and bottles of pills. Did they take their pill? Did they forget their pill? Sometimes we get a call in the office and they can't find their pill bottles. You know, where did they go? Well, they misplaced them. So this has opened up a whole direction, I think, for Faith in Action. We're a little bit more cognizant. At least I try to make my volunteers aware to really, when we go out and take a look at the senior, to spend some time with them and be very observant of what's happening to the senior out there. Because we do want them to be able to live in their home, but to be able to live in their home so that they are safe. Some of the things that we do for the seniors, in addition to taking them to doctor's visits, is we also take them to the local food bank to make sure that they get nourishment. And in addition to that, we are, we're also giving out brochures or booklets that show how to stretch, show how to do exercises, so that whenever they are sitting there, rather than just being stagnant in the chair, there's ways to manipulate the ankles or the arms so that we can once again so that they can once again regain balance, something that is being lost if you just sit around. What this has also shown me, it's really brought to light, is to how I want to go forward in life as I mature. And I'm maturing, and I'm maturing, and I'm maturing. But what I want to do is take an example from what I don't want to be. I don't want to be that stagnant person that is going to be sitting in that rocking chair. I don't want to be the person that is going to be having a counter full of pills. By coming to this type of a seminar and being associated with Dr. Valentine, with Dr. Chaudre, and with all the other wonderful people at Sinclair, I'm learning a new life. I'm not saying that I'm perfect at it. Believe me, I am not. But I am finding more and more as I have turned to daily devotion, both in the morning and in the evening, to sort of calm myself so that I can get ready to help those seniors the next day who are calling in being very frustrated, not knowing where to turn, so that I'm not as frustrated as they are, so that I can be the calming voice that they need in order to go on. And for that, I thank, once again, Ruth Ann, thank you. Dr. Chaudre, thank you. Sinclair, thank you.
Thanks, Phyllis. My name is Ruth Fowler. This presentation that I'm going to give is really an example of what Dr. O'Neill told me about exercise. 5 years ago in my life, I was in a pretty good place. I had just stopped being the mayor of Murrysville. I had been on the council for 4 years. I was teaching a class out of the University of the South in Christianity. My kids were doing well. I was actually leading a pretty sedentary life, but I was pretty happy and everything seemed pretty good. Until I decided to get off of a wall. And you know how if you're up on a wall, you sort of squat down on all fours and then you put a leg down? Well, the upper leg got stuck, so then I vaulted over. I really landed on my left leg. and I broke it, and I severed my ACL. So that was bad enough, but after that, I must say, things really got worse. I went to the doctor, and he said I was too old to have the ACL repaired. He said I would never probably return to normal. He had only seen one person who was able with an ACL to go up and play football, which I didn't aspire to do that, but I did think I could, you know, regain my former life. But he was not real promising about it. So I got a big black cast, and I got a set of crutches, and I was told to go home. So I did, and for a while that worked, and then I got weaker and weaker. I couldn't work the crutches, so I had to get some kind of chair. And it turned out that I got blood clots. And my leg was like almost totally backed up, so I ended up at the hospital. And when I got out, I was in such a poor state of health that I had friends stay overnight with me for the first week, and then friends brought me in food for about 2 weeks because I couldn't get up to cook. But gradually, I rallied. I had home health care. And eventually, I went to physical therapy, and I was there for 4 months. And when I left, the woman said to me, if you don't keep that leg strong, if you don't exercise, you will find you'll be walking down the sidewalk and you'll fall over. So I was advised to go to a gym, which I did. I've never been in a gym in my entire life. My idea of exercise was an hour of yoga and a 2 hour nap. But I went to the gym, and I had no clue what all those machines were about. So I hired a trainer, and I started in. And I must say, 4 years later, I really, really enjoy going to the gym. And I'll tell you some of the health benefits that have resulted from that, which Dr. Neal already suggested in her talk. I had the beginnings of osteoporosis, and that's totally leveled off. Used to be I went to, you know, every year it would be slightly worse. In 4 years, it has not gotten worse. I lost 40 pounds, and for each pound you weigh, it's 8 pounds of pressure on your knee. So that's 320 less pounds on my poor knee that I broke. My blood pressure is great. When doctors take it, they're surprised that it's so good. My heart is good. I take no medications whatsoever, but probably one of the most important things has been that I really gained a lot of muscle mass. I looked up on the computer and they say starting about age 30, women begin to lose between 3 and 5% of their muscles. So by the time you're 65, that's a significant amount of muscle loss if you're inactive. Well, that takes away strength, it takes away mobility, and you become very susceptible to falls, which, as you saw from my fall, just catapults into the catastrophic. So I was really able to reverse all this. I've done a lot of weight-bearing exercises. I now can carry my laundry from the basement to the second floor without stopping. I can, and maybe when you go home you want to try this. I noticed in church that when people want to stand up, they have to hold on to the pew in front of them in order to pull up because their legs aren't strong enough. It's very hard for some people to stand up without holding on to something or without pushing off. So that might be a test. I also read in the AARP magazine that if you can sit on the floor and stand up without putting your hands on the floor or helping in any way, you will tend to live longer. Well, I now can do that, and I'm very proud to say. I can pick up things when I drop them on the floor. I can carry my grandchildren and work puzzles on the floor. I can walk distances. And I recently turned 70, and I thought, you know what? I just feel very vital and very energetic and very healthy. And in large measure, it's thanks to all that exercise. So I very much recommend it. And thanks, Dr. O'Neill.
Thank you.
In the early 90s, there was a very interesting study published in Lancet, which is a premier medical journal in England. And what they did is they gave multiple articles regarding alternative medicine, integrative medicine, to a group of physicians. And they asked the physicians two questions. Do you feel that the studies were done properly and that the results are valid? And the second question is, do you believe the studies? Well, interestingly, 75% of the docs said the studies were good studies. But 25% of the docs said that they believed the studies. And I think this is so important because this gets to the crux of the matter, why we're here. And there are no doctors here except for the few brave ones. It has to do with the belief system. So when you go into your oncologist, for instance, they're not going to give you necessarily much hope. They're not going to give you anything to believe in. They're not going to give you any expectations other than their own expectations. And that's why we're here. Because you, as a community, give hope that there is a better way to live. And that's really what it's all about. Whether there were good studies to show that whatever you do makes any sense, it's not important. Because even if it's a so-called placebo effect, which most docs previously believed in, the old sugar pill that has absolutely no value, the point is there are a lot of Harvard researchers and researchers all over the country to show that the placebo effect has real effect in terms of the psychoneuroimmunology. And that's a whole other discussion for probably a week. So when I met Janet, we decided to do this thing with 12 cancer patients a year and a half ago. We were just amazed that by presenting talks regarding all aspects of integrative medicine, I asked it to be evidence-based as much as possible, give people the opportunity to talk, a lot of community time, dance, music. My wife was extremely instrumental in getting this thing off the ground. And every morning we would do a guided meditation, a little yoga, something else. And we were there from 8 in the morning until 10 at night. And by the end of the week, as I stated before, there was a major transformation in these people, something we had never expected. And quite frankly, we were transformed by this particular experience. And we hope to repeat that again this summer. Some of the presenters from our inaugural retreat are here at this time, and they just did a wonderful job, and they really connected with people. And so I just wanted to mention that to you. Thank you.
I'm Mary Price, a Sister of Charity of Seton Hill, and an educator, a spiritual director, a retreat director, and a pastoral minister in a parish. And back in September, I was shuffling papers at work at my desk, and I couldn't make decisions, and I couldn't drive. So I called Sister Catherine, who is our superior, and described my condition. And so she said that Dr. Chaudhry had been working with some of our sisters, and perhaps I would go to see him. So she got on the phone and was able to set the appointment up that day for 5:30. And being with him, I knew that that was going to be a good fit. So I was suffering from anxiety, panic attacks, depression, and just knew that I had to have help. I live in Pittsburgh, and so our mother house is in Greensburg, up at Seton Hill. So I called them and said, I have to come and live there. And so that worked out so well that I could be traveling to Belmont with a driver, of course. I say that I crawled into Sinclair, that And the people that work in the office know I couldn't sign papers, I couldn't track appointments, I couldn't make decisions. So fortunately, back at the mother house, the sister in charge of nursing, she would call back or email and get the appointment straightened out and give them to me. I think in my recovery, my relationship with God was certainly the most important. And at the center, they talk about meditation, and that is something that I have been doing for years. But I found that I would be drawn to healing stories in the gospel, and certainly prayed with many of them. And I remember a book that I read many years ago, written by Henry Nouwen, the spiritual director, spiritual writer, called The Wounded Healer. And so that title just kept coming to me over and over again. And so I had to allow my wounds to surface and to look at them, to name them, to enter into them so that I could go through healing. A second dimension that was so important to me was companions. And I found that many of our sisters reached out to me in ways that I would never imagine. One friend, Annette, she would call me every day, or in the evening, and we would talk and she would check in. If anyone's familiar with the Enneagram personality theory, I'm a three. And a three is very success-oriented. And so having a breakdown certainly didn't go along with that. Fortunately, Annette is also a three. So when I would describe things, she could relate so well to them and just say the right thing for me. I had friends that would take me to a local convent. They would take me out to dinner. And I came to the point that I would say, thank you for taking me out of the home. Companions would be certainly Dr. Shadray and Greta, my therapist, and all the staff that helped me. I found that the classes were really very informative. There were times that I couldn't do what was suggested, but fortunately I have a rich background in my education and my experience sitting with other people in spiritual direction, so the skills were there and the things that I needed, but these people helped to coax them out of me again to bring about transformation. The third category would be the praxis. And we've heard over and over today about exercise. And fortunately, I've been doing that for probably 30 years. And walking is one of my best forms. And I started to do that until the snow and the ice came abundantly this past winter. So fortunately, in Mother House, we have a wellness center. So I was able to set up my routine of exercise with the equipment. I also did yoga. When I studied in Berkeley years ago, I had a yoga teacher, and it was called Body Praise. And one of my friends serviced an old cassette and a tape player. So I would use that, and it was stretching, deep relaxation, and then guided visualization. So early on, I was on the floor in my bedroom doing the yoga, and an aide came in. Well, she had to report that she found me on the floor. So then I made a sign, yoga in process. But that didn't even hold up because an aide still came in, changed my water, give me fresh water. Mindfulness was really a big help, and I try to continue to use that in my daily life and journaling. And in the classes, I heard about self-soothing. So I was fortunate to be able to receive massage, and Sister Bernadette in my community would do Reiki for me up at the Mother House. Another thing that was so important were the cards that I received. They started coming in, and the sister postmistress said, "Is this your birthday?" So all the cards that I got were so helpful, all the prayer, I just feel it as a mantle around me, giving me strength and support. And so I put those in a basket and I would pull them up and read them to be reminded. Over the years, I've done grief work, dream work, and now I'm doing healing work. And I'm back in Pittsburgh and ministering in two parishes and back in the local community and really doing very well. One parishioner said to me, "Oh, how's your leg coming?" And so I said, "Oh, it's fine."
Sister, I hate to interrupt.
The one question. This is from Mother Seton. "Keep well to the grace of the moment. Do your best and leave the rest to God."
Hi, my name is Kim Kraft, and I am a wild, wonderful warrior wounded who has found her gifts as a healer. I'd like to take you back, and I'm intentionally not scripted this.
Can we talk a little more?
I've intentionally not scripted this because I wanted to come from the heart. 4 years ago in January, and let me say, first of all, 4 years ago in January, I had a connective tissue disorder, Marfan syndrome, probably familiar with that, and I had a facial deformity and ended up having 35 surgeries and over a 25-year period. And 4 years ago in January, I was a loose woman and I wasn't having any fun. So I decided to take the next step in my spiritual journey, and I got down on my knees and I told God that I would do whatever it took to follow him wholeheartedly. I was on a cocktail of opiates and benzos and barbiturates that would have probably killed half of this room. I went to a rapid detox program in Michigan where they detox you in a 3-hour period. Unfortunately, or maybe fortunately for me, I don't know, I learned a lot of lessons. They didn't get the opiates out of my system. So I woke up in an acute withdrawal with bile spewing from both ends of my hotel room with an EMT servicing 15 patients. I begged to die, pleaded to die. Faced death's door and somehow just continued to put one foot in front of the other. And actually, when you open your hands to God and give him no holds barred, don't always expect the sun to come shining immediately through. It's probably a year and a half later I started the benzo taper. And when I got down to a certain dosage in my benzos, anybody knows anything about benzos, I went crazy. And crazy as far as I went, I couldn't catch a thought. It's like, you know, by all purposes, you probably would have thought, that I was seriously mentally ill. I ended up getting 302 by my family. And then went into a deep, dark depression and was contemplating suicide. I ended up going to, then making a phone call, and I went to Florida, and I actually got myself a 64-day stint in a spiritual rehab where I got reconnected to my spiritual roots and, again, continued to send out what I call a holy hell. Some of those, you know, and I was also in the medical field, so I was I worked in a high-state, as a diagnostic medical sonographer, so what I've had to do is completely flip my my pyramid as to what healing is. So I just integrated just a lot of meditative, healthy lifestyle, practices, and I said I found out that I saw Alf. Is anyone familiar with Alf? I saw Alf, I guess, 8 months ago, and he said, he said, I thought you were possessed. He said, then I realized that you just had a very, very serious chronic pain problem. He said, it's going to take all five of us. They worked on me for an hour, and then he said, Jim, he said, you've suffered long enough. He said, it's now for you. He said, it's time for you to become that wounded healer. Since then, I've been putting my hands on people and learning new practices and just have seen some amazing things. So I've gone from being the problem to being the solution. And thank God for the journey.
It's quite an honor to be here with all of these courageous people. I'm Joanne Spence, and I have an accent, and there's been some very interesting accents today, so I thought I'd add Australia and Wilkinsburg into the mix. So I'm a social entrepreneur, a recovering social worker, and a yoga therapist, among other things. I'm the executive director of yoga in schools. I've got a big t-shirt with that emblazoned front and back, just in case you forget. It's very exciting to know that we can have these mind-body practices in schools. But the reason I'm sitting up here is because I had the wonderful honor of being the very first yoga therapist at Western Psychiatric Institute and Clinic. And this is not new. This is 7 years. And there are two of us now on staff, and that's our official title, despite the fact that we're both social workers. Our title and our role at the hospital is yoga therapist. And we work as part of the creative and expressive arts team. And it just feels like a really good place to be. That's groundbreaking and an honor to sit with people in difficult spaces and to realize their story is our story. And some of the things that I was hearing this morning from Dr. Chowdhury about meditating, from Dr. O'Neill about movement, and some other of you that said some really wonderful things about awareness, and just it takes time to heal. And someone else mentioned, I just love that, I finally have found the right team. And when I thought about those words together, I thought that was a pretty good description of what I get to do several times a week at Western Psych. So I would hope that wherever you are today and wherever you're practicing for yourself or with your patients, that brings you some hope that that's happening in traditional psychiatric inpatient care right here in southwestern Pennsylvania. So I feel very glad to do that. And the way that I do that is very concrete, because some of you probably think of yoga and think of maybe somebody looks different to me, or you might think of some poses that if I did them, I would have to go to the emergency room. Or we think of, you know, them being our body like a pretzel. And the truth is that all you need is your body and your breath. The irony is that it's a $6 billion industry. But it's really good news to know that we have access to something that is just using our body and our breath. So I do that with patients and make that very concrete on a daily basis. So we can talk about that all we want, but unless we actually do it, it doesn't mean a lot. So if you wouldn't mind just for a moment, I know that we've done some mindfulness practices. But at least you can go home and say, not only did you do mindfulness practices, not only did we do that fabulous movement with Greta, thank you, that was wonderful, but that we did some breathing, and you can go home and you say you did yoga as well, because that's what the practice is. So if you can just sit up for a moment and find your feet on the floor, and yoga is about stating the obvious, so we just notice things, we notice everything. We notice our feet. You notice what your bottom is doing. You're letting your spine get tall. And you can have your eyes open. You can have them closed. But just be comfortable. And notice how you're breathing. And we have this wonderful thing in yoga called the three-part yogi breath. But all that means is that you're going to breathe in and out through your nose. And you're going to find a little space, just a little pause between the inhale and the exhale. And the exhale and the inhale. It's really tiny, but it's important. And then sit in your belly. Maybe you want your hand on your belly. Going in and out. Just the gentle in and out. And just notice how that shifts. It's free. You can do it whenever you want. Just notice that. And after raising about $500,000 worth of funds to take this sort of practice into schools, this is what I believe works the best. Thank you.
Thank you, Jenny.
These are hard acts to follow. I'm Patty Lemer. I'm a licensed professional counselor, and I work for the last 45 years primarily with families of people with disabilities. I became an expert on learning disabilities in the 70s because I was the only one who'd ever seen anybody, so I had an N of one. And in the 80s, it turned into attention deficit disorder. And in the 90s, you know where we are from then until now, it turned into autism. So I have learned from the people I've worked with what works for them, what's going on with them, and heard many, many, many stories. I've spoken at a lot of conferences, and I often ask to be the last one to speak because I love to play cleanup, and that's just sort of what happened today. And they tell you when you speak that first you tell them what you're going to talk about, and you tell them what you want them to know, and then you tell them what you told them. So I decided that that's what I was going to do, and I ended up here in the last seat, which was kind of interesting. So health for me has, and for my clients, has always been really about two things. And the first thing is to reduce the stressors and to reduce the amount of garbage that comes in. And you've heard all the different ways to do that from all these wonderful speakers. And to enhance your body's ability to get the garbage out. And that's the way you stay healthy. It's that simple. Just reduce the garbage in and get the garbage out. So it isn't that simple, though, is it? So we live in a toxic world, and so we have to figure out how we're going to reduce the garbage that gets in. And everybody, every single speaker talked about the stressors. And those stressors just come from so many different places. And I'm going to just hit quickly on the five that I think are the most important. And we always start with air, food, and water. We have to get enough of those in and make sure that they're good quality. We had a delicious lunch, and Alyssa, my friend back there, brought some even higher quality lunch. And so you're always looking for the highest quality of food that you can buy, you can afford, that is available. So when you make your dietary choices, that's what you want. You want to reduce your environmental toxins every single purchase that you make, whether it's your toothpaste, whether it's your dishwasher detergent, whether it's your lipstick, whatever it is, you want to reduce the toxins in that. And we have so many wonderful ways to do that today. The personal care products, the environmental working group tells us we can have an app for that even. To find the right personal care products. You can make your own cleaning products. Vinegar and baking soda and water are about the best way to get everything clean, and then you can add a little propolis and tea tree oil, and you've killed all the bacteria and all the viruses and gotten rid of all the dirt. So you don't have to buy water by buying Windex. And the last area that is more garbage, I don't know if anybody has touched on a little bit maybe, are the environmental electromagnetic fields. And they're so dangerous. They come from our cell phones, which are getting stronger and stronger. They come from our wireless phones, which are broadcasting next to our heads while we're trying to get restorative sleep. They come from our big plasma televisions. They come from our iPods, our iPads, and all the different electronics that we and our children use, and they do not belong in the bedroom. So that's the garbage that comes in. So how do we enhance our body's ability to get the garbage out? And this is all the ways that have been practiced today. Again, with food, Janet told us wonderful antioxidant foods. We ate some delicious foods, the blueberries. You can even have them for dessert. And so there's wonderful foods that help us get our bodies clean. And that's obviously the best way to do it. Because our foods are limited and the seasons limit us and other things limit us, our location limits us, we have to supplement it. So we want to use good quality supplements. And all supplements, like all foods, are not created equal. We have to use pharmaceutical grade supplements, and you have great people here who can tell you their favorite sources of these supplements, and whether it's fish oil or no fish oil or sea and no sea or whatever it is, we're all unique. And what works for one doesn't always work for another. So we've got to find our team who can help us find our right supplements. And then there's exercise. Thank you, Greta, for such a wonderful exercise regime, which we all should be doing every day, and it's finding time for it. 10 minutes now, 10 minutes later, 10 minutes at lunchtime, you can get it into your day. And when you exercise, you help your body detoxify in two ways. You sweat, and you do yoga, you sweat, and sweat is our body's way of getting those toxins out. One of our largest organs, our skin, and you poop better. And if you've ever been to an autism conference, the number one topic at every autism conference I've ever been to is pooping. And people don't like to talk about poop, but it's the most important thing that your body has. So I will leave you with that. Thank you.
Well, I actually saw the biggest rise when you said poop. So that was, you know, that some people were sleeping, I think, maybe. I'm not sure. A couple things I wanted to say. I'm very involved with health promotion. And as you were saying, Doc Wetschler, correct? Wetschler?
Yes.
He said there's not many docs here. You know what? Look at all the people that empowered themselves to make changes, or empowered their communities, or empowered the groups you're in to do that. And you might say, what can I do? And this is, again, from research. Judd Allen, whose father, Dr. Robert Allen, did a lot of research on healthy communities, healthy cultures. Share the vision. You know, you might work somewhere where they don't provide healthy food. You might work somewhere where you're not afforded to go to trainings, like Dr. Chaudre says, you know, my staff, I want them to enjoy this too. So, you know, share that vision. And it's not, and I don't want to belittle eating and exercising, but do you know now health and wellness in the worksite is looking more at engagement? People like working here. People like the way they're treated here. People like the way we do things around here. And if you think of your home, you might say, what can I do? My home, share the vision. Sit and talk with your family. Why do we have these vegetables here? Why do we have water in the refrigerator instead of sodas? Because I care about you. I love you. I care about you. Did you notice how many things today were about love? Taking care of your body, taking care of your home, taking care of your environment. And you can share that vision. Your kids won't like it that maybe the plate is full of what they're supposed to eat. But when they're like my children and they're 38, 36, they said to me, I'm glad you made me eat those vegetables. And my daughter's now a vegan and she would like gag on vegetables, okay? Model. You know, I worked in the drug and alcohol addiction field for several years, and I would have people that would come in. I worked in the DUI program, and they would say, I'm telling my kids they better not be drinking and driving, and they're smoking a cigarette and talking about it. And I said, how do you expect your child to do that when they don't see that modeled? What we do is so much more important than what we say. And that's what you'll think of too. Reward and recognize. Oh my God, we would think this was Dr. Chaudhry's, you know, congratulations dinner today, right? But I mean, really, he deserves recognition. The people on our panel deserve recognition. But if we need to reward for things other than you sold the most products this month, you know what? Who is getting us out walking? Who do you go to at work because you need someone to talk to? Here's your peer mentor. So there's so many more things we can reward and recognize. It's not all about the money. Here's an example. I've offered to do some things at places, even with my doctor's office. I said, you know, I could come in here and do smoking cessation. I could do this or that. Who's going to pay for it? Kim, my friend Kim, she's having a problem right now with her medical insurance. They'll put her on all the drugs she wants, but she can't get more physical therapy visits. She doesn't want on drugs. So we can't change the drug community right now, the drug companies. We can't change maybe things, but start in your own home. Just like today, you know, we always have water. That could be something. We have the healthy foods or the easy choice. You know, years ago when we always had birthday cakes for birthdays, people never had a birthday cake. And it was a really great thing. And now we have them all the time. So those are sometimes foods. So it's really nice if we can just start in our own home, maybe take it to the work site, take it to your kids' little league teams and say, you know what, please don't be giving my kids monster drinks. You know, can we maybe have a policy? Maybe the soccer league can have a policy that we do water. And we think people know this, but they don't. And it's just like anything. Well, that's not the way we do things around here. We've never done it that way. Well, let's start doing it that way. Does anybody have any questions? I know we don't have a lot of time. Any questions for our panel? Any comments? Yes.
I have one comment. I'm in Catholic school, and I'm just so proud of sisters. Because that's not the sisters we saw with
you. Well, that's great.
Anybody else?
Okay, let's see, Krishna, do we have a minute?
Yes, you do.
Oh, yes.
Oh, I just heard a few of you mentioned how important God was, and I forgot the all things about God. God heard my little speech there. I mean, without him, I couldn't know this before.
Right.
So it's great to relate to people's faith and hear his words.
Thank you very much. I would just like to relate two little things. I also teach yoga, Joanne. And I'm doing some yoga in an after-school program. And I was going through my music. It would say spirit. It would say God. It would say, I thought, well, can't do that. So you know what? We talk about our heart. What's in your heart? Kindness, gratitude, compassion, forgiveness. When I did my yoga training, I was told not to talk spiritually. My yoga training where I did it was pretty much, it's a physical activity. And I was very frustrated. I wanted to connect the body, mind, and spirit. And it was like, nope, we're not getting into that. So
I thought, when I start teaching my own yoga, that's how I'm teaching it. And actually, I think that's why people are coming now. Because you can get physical exercise a lot of places, but when you can connect the body, mind, and spirit. So do what you can do. That's the beginning. Do what you can do and follow the examples of all these wonderful people, and we know where we can get great resources. Yes?
I just want to let you comment on Joanne. I haven't recognized you in physical I was in school learning as a therapist when Joanne was in the big yoga. And it's not only that the kids move in a different way and learn yoga and learn breathing and relaxation, but it's really changing cultures. And I just remember some of the teachers, like, what the heck are these kids doing? You just take your train going to the gym. And it was like, oh, because everyone has to go like that. And you know, like, I think it's just the culture is changing.
Yes.
Bringing the yoga to school, and I think it's wonderful.
Joanne, did you want to make a comment about that?
Thank you. It is making a difference. Yes, it does.
Anybody else? Okay, thank you.